Welcome to the Urban Complex, a system of interrelated, emotion-charged ideas, feelings, memories, and impulses. This name takes the definition and lays out what a listener should expect. A podcast where ideas, feelings, and memories collide, leading towards meaningful change. I'm co-host Chris Richardson. Please enjoy the journey with the Urban Complex. Smarter cities for a stronger tomorrow.
All opinions by Chris Richardson, Dominic Poppa, and podcast guests are solely their own opinions and do not reflect the opinions of Arizona State University, the Arizona Department of Education, or the Arizona Commerce Authority. Any endorsement of or messages from sponsors are solely supporting the production of this podcast. There is no relationship further than podcast purposes with any sponsor unless separately created with another entity. Enjoy the Urban Complex. Smarter cities for a stronger tomorrow.
All right, Chris, here we are, man. Another week. What's top of mind for you this week?
You know, I just am excited. We got another type of area that's under the city umbrella that we really haven't dug into yet. And that is police force, first response, dispatch. From my experience, I've done some work with call centers in the past at Honeywell, and we had Axon, the CEO of Axon, Rick Smith, on to talk about the tech evolutions, primarily serving police departments. We haven't really dug into the city side of what's going on in law enforcement and response. So this should be interesting.
Yeah. So who is that and where is he from?
His name is Bill Shire, and he is with this. He's been with the city of Seattle for a long time. He's actually consulting in a number of engagements.
Awesome.
We normally talk about how we know folks. Once this is one of those, again, I just saw some social media presence, and I think he was speaking at some event, and I dug into what he does, and it's in this new space. So I just reached out to him, and he was very accommodating to work with us, and that's how we own. So
a little bit of a
cold call, and, awesome. And hopefully it works out.
Yeah, very cool. You know, I think obviously police first responders are quite in the news quite often, especially in Seattle. So it'd be great to hear his story.
Awesome.
Let's get him on.
Let's do it.
All right. Here we go.
Support for this episode of The Urban Complex comes from Worldwide Technology.
What if we could connect people to new possibilities, turn thinking into a way forward, solve problems before they become a problem, and share the future with everyone? We can. At WWT, we connect businesses to technology to make the impossible possible, to reach better decisions faster, to accelerate progress. Together, let's make a new world happen.
Bill, please let Dom and I give you a warm welcome to our podcast, The Urban Complex. Thanks for joining.
Thank you. Awesome. I'm really glad to be here.
Yeah. We have found over time the best way for our guests to build affinity with the audience. Just start with your background and kind of use your own personal spin. Talk about you. What do you want our podcast to know about you as a person and your kind of career? And we'll dig into some of your most recent work soon. So, but feel free to kind of bring us up to speed.
Hey, that sounds good. So I think probably the biggest part of my career has been working at the city of Seattle in various forms of technology. My last position at full-time position at the city was as chief technology officer. So I headed the Department of Information Technology. I worked for an elected mayor, made it through a mayoral transition without getting fired, which is always a big deal for a cabinet member in the city, in a municipal government.
Yep.
We worked, that was a little bit before smart cities work, although we were working on several things that had to do with digital government at that time. Things like open data initiatives. Some of my other experience includes, I spent a stint as the CIO for the Seattle Police Department on an interim basis. And in fact, I'm presently consulting for the Seattle 911 Center, which was pulled out of the police department earlier this year and made into a separate department. So based on my city experience, I'm helping establish that 911 center as a separate department. And we'll talk about that. And then a long, long time ago, in a city far, far away called Dubuque, Iowa, I was a street cop. I was a police officer.
Wow.
And I left Dubuque for love. I married my wife in the Midwest. We were both going to the University of Wisconsin. And but she was from Washington State, so we ended up in Seattle.
Good that's choice. Great. That's where I'm from. Love the background too. Way to represent.
There you go.
The background's great. I knew Chris was going to enjoy that. All right, so Bill, this is the most difficult question. We always have a lot of fun with this because, as we know, there's no true definition of smart cities, but it's been a real fun process to ask our guests what their view and perspective of smart cities is because of the various backgrounds that they bring to the topic. And so we'd love our audience to know, kind of with your background, what's your view of smart cities? How do you approach it? What do you think's working and what's not working?
Well, I'll take kind of an opposite tack there. Yeah. And that is, what's a dumb city?
Yeah. Good point.
So, I mean, who wants to live in a dumb city? For one thing, smart city is kind of a misnomer. It covers a lot of sins, if you will. But I guess it's the moniker that we're stuck with at the present time. And I guess I would say that a dumb city is a city, and there's no such thing really as a dumb city. Every city has got some automation, some use of technology to improve quality of life for citizens. But a smart city uses technology intelligently. And that technology includes networking, mobile devices, sensors, to better control its infrastructure, better manage its infrastructure, and therefore improve the quality of life for citizens. And we can go into a lot more detail on that, but that would be my fundamental definition. A smart city is also not a dumb city.
Yeah. Yeah, I love it. I mean, so many people in this space have said the same thing, that, you know, that they can't stand the name, that tagline smart cities. I think it was Brenna Berman, former CIO of City of Chicago. She's like, man, I wish we could go figure out who started that way back when and take them out back. But yeah, that's great. I love that idea and that perspective. So Bill, you mentioned what you're kind of doing with the 911 center. Give our audience some background on that. What is it? What's the initiative? And kind of what are you up to?
Well, how do you get a hold of 911? That's kind of a stupid question because, of course, you have to call. You have to make a telephone call. Used to be it was a landline telephone call. Of course, now 80% or more of calls come in from cell phones. But still, fundamentally, you call on the telephone. You don't go to the web. You don't send a photograph. You don't send video evidence to a 911 center. You don't send email or documents, typically. You telephone. So the work I'm doing with the 911 center, first of all, is taking the city of Seattle's 911 center, pulling it out of the police department, that's already been done structurally, and creating a separate department. There are about 140 people in the city's 911 center. About 120 of those are call takers and dispatchers. That function's separated, so the people who take the calls are different from the people who are dispatched. It's kind of a promotion to move from call taker to dispatcher. There's a computer aided dispatch system, CAD, that's the automated way that the calls move through. So you call 911, the call taker takes your incident, asks some questions about it, some pertinent questions, like, is there a weapon involved, or is anybody known to use weapons? Does anybody have COVID or is exhibiting COVID symptoms as a recent one? It's typed into the CAD, the computer dispatch system, and then the dispatcher dispatches a resource. In Seattle, the resources are either fire and rescue, the Seattle Fire Department, or the Seattle Police Department, for everything that isn't a medic call or is a fire. And in the case of the police department, it's a police patrol unit that typically shows up, not a detective, not a special unit like a SWAT team. Typically, it's a patrol unit that will show up at the call. But fundamentally, the 911 center is about taking 911 calls and from citizens or residents of the city, determining the priority and the nature of the call, and dispatching police. And Seattle has got about 750,000 people, residents of the city, and probably another, it used to be a couple hundred thousand. You know, Amazon's headquartered here. There are 55,000 employees from Amazon alone downtown. Now, post-pandemic, we still have workers downtown, but not quite as many.
How about, that's really interesting. And this is this is our first foray kind of into the police, the dispatch center, the first responsive side. So we're going to ask some really dumb questions probably in your world, but you know, just help kind of convey what's happening. So before this new work, you were, I think you said you're only a month into this new consulting gig. You'd been with the First Responder Network. What is that? And what was innovative on that side?
Okay, that's a good question. And actually, I've been at this job consulting at the 911 Center for about 6 months. I got permission from the federal government to actually take it on as an additional gig when I worked for the First Responder Network Authority.
Awesome.
Oh, wow.
So the First Responder Network Authority is a federal government agency. It's part of the United States Department of Commerce. Dom, you mentioned you work for the kind of the equivalent in Arizona. The First Responder Network Authority is part of the Department of Commerce. It was created in 2012. It's a relatively new agency and relatively small, about 200 employees, and charged with creating a nationwide wireless network, this is, for cops and firefighters. I oftentimes call it smartphones and tablet computers for cops and firefighters, because the thing that's unique about this network, the FirstNet network, and there are a number of things which are unique, but the primary thing that's unique is priority. Police officers and firefighters using FirstNet get priority over other users. So you can think of a situation where you've got a crowd or a demonstration, and all of a sudden a car drives through that demonstration, knocking people over and injuring people. You want your medics, you want your firefighters, your police officers to be able to get on that cell phone and have priority to help out people that are at that incident. And we know that concerts, football games, I guess Arizona State even has a football team, if I remember right, the Seattle Seahawks, those games can be pretty busy. They can be pretty busy with people texting and tweeting and sending video. And you want your cops and firefighters to have priority. But that's what the FirstNet network is.
It's priority of the network itself, too, because it's its own wavelength, so to speak, so that they have direct access and their needs get prioritized, too. So there's dual prioritization technically and process-wise. Is that what I'm hearing?
Yes, you're right. There's 20 megahertz of spectrum, and megahertz is a technical term, of course, but that's a good-sized chunk of spectrum that was allocated to my agency, the FirstNet Authority, to deploy the network. Now, what actually has happened is the FirstNet Authority issued an RFP. AT&T won that RFP. There were other bidders. And has deployed the network. So AT&T operates and maintains the FirstNet network. And you actually have priority if you're a first responder on all AT&T spectrum, not just that slice of spectrum. But that slice of spectrum is neat because it's available totally across the United States and all of its territories. The Virgin Islands, for example, American Samoa, that spectrum's available throughout the United States.
Well, and how is it constructed? So Department of Commerce you mentioned, but like, is it public? Is it private? Is it, what's the relationship with AT&T or other suppliers? Like what's the construct?
Great question, Chris. So it's a public-private partnership, a true public-private partnership. The First Responder Network Authority, the federal agency, brought $6.5 billion allocated by Congress to the partnership. And that money is not taxpayer money. That money came from sale of spectrum.
So did you say billion or million? Involved.
Pardon?
Billion or million?
Billion.
Billion. That's what I thought.
$6.5 billion. Wow. Also, the FirstNet Authority brought the spectrum, the 20 megahertz of spectrum to the network as well. Plus, it brought its authority. This is the federal government and the First Responder Network Authority, a federal agency, endorses the network. AT&T brought towers. They brought 40 to 50,000 towers. They brought additional spectrum. They brought network engineers to actually deploy the network by putting additional antennas and equipment at cell sites. And of course, they brought priority, all their networking technology to the table.
And how do if cities aren't using it or not adopting, how do they get on board with the responder network?
They contact their local AT&T rep.
That's it.
Bottom line. Actually, AT&T has a separate organization. It's called sometimes called FirstNet, or I use the term AT&T FirstNet, of several hundred people that actually develop some of the services on the network, things like special applications and an applications catalog, things like high-powered user equipment, and then actually sell and service the network. They're called principal consultants. So if you're a city or a county or a state or a federal agency, you contact your AT&T rep to get on. And as of right now, there are about 2.8 million connections on the network. We think that there's probably 5 million first responders in the United States. And I'm using those terms a little differently. The connection could be a mobile data computer in a car as opposed to a smartphone, but it gives you some idea of the scale.
Wow. That's incredible. What a good story. This is the fun part about this podcast is our audience, you know, CIOs, city managers, other police, you know, chiefs and captains, they learn from all these stories because they're just so incredible. So let's talk about, you know, police management and its police force management and its technology. Talk to us about what it was like, you know, to be the CIO of Seattle Police. Any good lessons learned or any experiences that have helped you, you know, as you progress through your career?
Yeah, and actually, just a moment here. I'm going to go back further than that to awesome. The time I was a police officer. Oh. And I remember being a police officer, I got my first real dose of technology, and it was this. It was a land mobile radio, a handheld land mobile radio. We always had radios in the police vehicle, but once I stepped out of my police car, I was basically out of touch with dispatch. And I depended on citizens or the people I was talking to actually call if I got into trouble. Yeah. This technology, which I got about halfway through my career as a police officer, all of a sudden meant that I could actually contact dispatch and get help when I needed, no matter where I was. And again, that's a land mobile radio. On the police management side, we've seen a tremendous explosion in technology over the last 20 years. And it mirrors what has happened in the consumer world. How old is the iPhone now? Is it? It's about 20 years old, isn't it?
I think 2008 it came to life. Yeah,
2008. So the smartphone and the iPhone being one of the first smartphones is now widely adopted by police departments and fire departments. Mobile data computers in cars, so that the computer-aided dispatch system, the incident can actually show up. Mapping, and then of course, body-worn video technology. All of those things are really recent developments within the last 10 to 15 years.
Yeah, it must be wild watching that, the kind of hockey stick, you know, development of the adoption of tech, especially in the police force. It's gotta be pretty remarkable.
So, that actually gets back to the 911. There is an initiative, a nationwide initiative called Next Generation 911 to allow residents and callers to actually contact the 911 center in different fashions. In many places, you can now text 911, but you should be able to do things like send an email. Or if you've got a video of a suspect or a photo of a suspect, you ought to be able to send that to a 911 center.
Can we talk about that for a second? Because when you were talking about the center before, I thought you were going to go that way. But really, you're creating the space in a new capacity. Is it because you need standards there? If why you're not tackling that? Or is it just you got to get your ducks in a row first? Like how is that going to evolve, this next gen 911?
A good question, Chris. So we need three things. We need money, standards, and money. I guess that might be three things. We do need standards in terms of standard ways of transmitting that material, the multimedia, if you will, to 911 centers. But we also need other things as well. What happens when a white powder is discovered at your 911 center? Has happened in Seattle, and you've got to evacuate it. you have to transfer the calls elsewhere. You have to have the computer-aided dispatch system elsewhere. So part of next generation 911 is something called an ESI net, Emergency Services Internet. And that allows, that interconnects a whole bunch of 911 centers so that one could evacuate to the to another, or Seattle can ship its 911 calls to, say, Bellevue, which is a suburb of Seattle. So there's a lot of aspects to next generation 911. And we're making progress, but we need those standards promulgated by national organizations so we all do it more or less the same.
Yeah, no, that definitely makes sense. You know, so I know this, Bill, this was a little bit after your time, but obviously, you know, Seattle was home and the epicenter for some major events, some social unrest. And I know a lot of people around the country was watching. You know, what do these types of events and these changes, what have you seen that they've meant for cities in general and really the police force approach? Has there been major changes since?
Boy, that's another great question, Dom. And I presume you're talking about recent events like the murder of George Floyd last year in Minneapolis and other events where individuals have been killed by police officers.
Or even the change like Capitol Hill and some of the defunding that was kind of related is downstream. Like, I think you're right on. Like, it just seems to put some unique pressure. We're curious your view of what's in store.
Yeah, that's a good point, Chris. And when we're talking Capitol Hill here for our listeners, we're talking Capitol Hill, which is a particular hill in Seattle. Seattle was built on seven hills, like Rome, we used to say, although we actually sluiced one of those hills, Denny Hill, into the Elliott Bay. So now there's only six hills. But Capitol Hill is an area close to downtown. And last year, there were multiple riots and demonstrations in that area, a trashing of buildings and businesses. And actually, the Seattle Police Precinct in that neighborhood was evacuated because the demonstrations became so bad. It wasn't taken over by demonstrators. It was boarded up, but it was evacuated by the police. So it was a pretty serious situation. And this was in 2020 on Capitol Hill. One of the outcomes of that is seven of nine city council members pledged to defund the Seattle Police Department by 50%. Wow. Well, they did that within days of being asked to do it. And as a matter of fact, it's not happened, thank goodness. What they have done is they have taken some pieces out of the Seattle Police Department, the Emergency Operations Center, the 911 Center, and made them separate. They've also created some new units, the city council has. There's a unit called Health One with trained medics and firefighters to respond to health emergencies. Next year, we'll create a unit called Triage One, which will have mental health professionals and social workers, because many of the incidents that we send police to today are really incidents that involve people undergoing a mental crisis or homelessness. And we also hope to have more resources than just police officers to send to these scenes where people are in crisis.
Yeah, well, that's interesting. The knee-jerk reaction was to defund, but then in the end, they kind of re-looked at things, asked some questions, and actually sounds like they're innovating a little bit, created some new units to kind of respond in a unique way. That's a lot better. It's interesting how in the throes of it, you don't hear that's what results, at least we don't outside of Seattle. I don't know what's been presented there, but. So
if you look nationwide, there's actually a number of innovative things going on. We have 911 centers that have mental health professionals that actually will jump onto calls with call takers. We do have a national 211 initiative. Many it's not really nationwide, but many cities have 211 for people in crisis. You might call it there's also an initiative to stand up 988, a national suicide prevention hotline. So there's a number of things that actually have come out of these events that hopefully will get us to the point where we don't have to send cops to every incident.
That's great. That sounds great, because cops may not be well-suited for certain things they're being dispatched to, is what I'm hearing.
Exactly.
So we do close with two standard questions, but before we do that, just curious to see if we were more the city management side, or, you know, the leader at council, or maybe the IT leader that's not thinking technically, they're thinking how to enable their peers to advance the best of police force work or response initiatives. How what's your advice to them on not necessarily the technology, but how to think about police force evolution, response initiatives, kind of the way you're seeing the call center? Like, how do they make these things come to life?
Good point. So I'm going to talk just a moment about the technology, though. We've got body-worn video. We need things like object recognition and body-worn video. We need speech to text so what's being said on a body-worn video can be translated into text for a police report. Both 911 centers and police departments need speech to text actually for creating reports. But we also need an ability for residents, if they're going to report a crime, there's actually online crime reporting now, if it's not a crime in progress. We ought to be able to speak to that. Rather than typing into a computer what your crime was, a resident ought to be able to talk to the application and report the crime. So we get a true picture of what crime is. So there's lots of technology innovations that we should have. And a big one, frankly, is 311. We should have a nationwide non-emergency number for people who are not in an immediate emergency to request any sort of service from their government. In terms of advice to elected officials, my biggest piece of advice, which is really hard for elected officials because they're always thinking about the next election, is be patient. What we want here is culture change. We want to change the culture of the organization. And I'm not necessarily talking about a police department, although I can be, but I'm also talking about government organizations in general. Get out of that bureaucratic mindset. Get out of that, here are the rules that need to be followed, and get into how do we improve the quality of life for our people, and hire people who are innovative and give them a little breathing room to be innovative in that fashion.
Yeah.
Great advice. Well, we do ask, what can we do to help you do more? Whether it's just getting the message out is one, but we have doors we can open. We have connections. We might have a listener that's listening to this that might be able to do exactly what you need. So we just like to ask, like, what's something that you think about as you're approaching your work that, oh, if I could only have this, what would it be?
Yeah, I can think of several things right off the top.
Besides of my money, head. Money, and money.
Actually, it would be innovation, money, and innovation. Innovation is another one of those overused terms, as you both know, I'm sure. There are a lot of really cool startups in the technology space right now in law enforcement and fire and rescue. Things like, a robot. There's a company that makes a robot the size of a bath towel that you can toss into a building. It's got a camera on it, and it can actually roll through the building to determine if it's a building on fire, if there are people inside the building.
Wow.
I already mentioned the application where we should have an online crime reporting capability where a resident can talk to it and it interacts with natural language processing to actually report that crime. So there's a whole bunch of startup companies that are working in that vein, and we need police departments and fire departments to be test beds to try out this technology. Secondly, I recommend that you look for innovative leaders in this space. One of the best is Art Acevedo. He's the former police chief of Houston, and now he's the former police chief of Miami. He got crosswise with the elected officials in Miami. But the guy really thinks innovatively about community engagement and actually working with the community to improve law enforcement. One of my old bosses here in Seattle was Gil Kerlikowski. He was the police chief. We actually partnered on the precursor to FirstNet, creating the precursor to FirstNet. Kathy O'Toole is another one She was the police chief here in Seattle, but she also was the police commissioner in Boston, thinks innovatively. So look for those innovative leaders and their ideas and their better ways of engaging the community and getting away from the badge and gun type of law enforcement to more of the guardian mentality.
Well, you're kind of predicting our last question, which is, knowing us, knowing the urban complex, who would you recommend on the show? And who have you been appreciative of that's helped you on your journey? But I don't know. I'm guessing Art, Kathy, they may be some of those examples, but maybe I'm wrong.
Yeah, I've also got, I'll send you some of the names, but there are chief information officers in some departments that are really pushing this ball forward. Matt Slinkard's a deputy chief in Houston. And Mike Bell is his CTO are two examples. We have John Singleton in, he's the CIO for the Miami-Davidson County Police Department in Tennessee. And Jonathan Lewin just retired as the CIO for the Chicago Police Department. He now works for the First Responder Network Authority. One of the most innovative people I know, not just on the technology side, but on the people side of law enforcement.
Wow.
Awesome.
Well, I'll tell you, great stuff. I know I've learned a ton. That's kind of a wrap here. So with that, the Urban Complex gives a big note of thanks to today's guest, Bill Shire, consultant on Seattle's 911 Center Initiative, former senior advisor of the First Responder Network, FirstNet. Thanks for joining us, Bill.
Thank you, Chris. Thank you, Dom.
Yeah, you bet. Thanks a lot.
Support for this episode of the Urban Complex comes from MST.
MST is a Salesforce certified integrator. We work on building customer experience solutions and deploy them for our customers. As we started evolving, our why also continued to evolve as a company. Over the last 3 years, the whole approach was really revolving around what we call three C's, which is customers, colleagues, and community.
All right, Dom, that was Bill Shire. What'd you think?
Yeah, I mean, what a fascinating story. I thought Bill was fantastic. I mean, it's great, like you mentioned, and you know, before we brought him on, the idea of having this new perspective from the city and the police, which was very, I think, exciting and interesting for me. You know, I love this idea of this just like kind of organizational shift. It seems like Seattle's going through, not only because of the crisis and what we talked about, but it seemed, you know, to take a 911 center outside of the traditional police department, it seems like a major shift, but he seems to have everything in mind. And again, focusing on kind of the structure, the standards, getting everything in place. You know, it had to be very difficult, a difficult move. And it was exciting to see how he was approaching it. And I wonder if, you know, we might start to see similar efforts, you know, across the country.
Yeah, you know, I wish now at the time I'm thinking about it, it's a really good point. I should have asked the rationale, because they kind of talked about one question later, which I'll come back to in something I observed. But I wonder if it was a cost-effective thing because they've already got other call centers. You know, it's not like you can't train call center agents to be that call center triage, because that can be done all the time. That's just a script. And then dispatch is probably not that. They can probably transfer those people in, and then they have more economies of scale. I wish I would have asked that rationale. But yeah, I think that's great. I think what stuck out to me is not just the 911 and that it's moving out, but all the innovations around service and, you know, things that are coming out like 311 and next gen 911 and 211 and 988 suicide crisis and 911 that actually has mental health professionals that are getting on there. I mean, I didn't expect that at all when we were having him come on. I thought we were going to be talking more about evolution of police, evolution of a, you know, at the last minute, he told us that he's doing this 911 center thing. I didn't even see that on social. So that was just a really interesting observation that I wasn't aware of.
Yeah, it's so cool. I mean, right, the ability to understand that, hey, maybe the way we were doing it in the past isn't working, right? This fact that I love the having mental health on calls with the call takers, right, in the call centers responding to these at the same time. I mean, it's things that we kind of never thought before, but as we learn through these crises, you have to adapt, you have to evolve, you have to respond. And it's just, it's amazing to see them doing that entail, because you're right. I mean, all we heard was the negative, negative, negative.
Right.
And here he is, you know, the behind the scenes kind of leading the charge to innovate. I thought that was great.
Well, could you imagine being in the police when you're literally hearing 9 of your 11 council or 7 of your 9 council literally overnight saying you're defunding the police by 50%. I remember as a former Seattleite hearing about what was going on in Capitol Hill going, oh my gosh, are you serious? Like, what does that mean to the city? What does that mean to citizens? And I actually know some friends that moved here to Phoenix because of that. Like, that was freaking people out. But yet when cooler heads prevail and they dig into it, they actually use that crisis as an opportunity to transform, and they're creating Health One. Let's see my notes. There was another one, Triage One. They that was one of the impetus to change the service center. They created some new units. I just think that's really interesting that they unfortunately got pushed by the public eye to make some rash decisions, but they didn't end up doing that in the end, and they actually chose to innovate. So I think that's great.
Yeah, it was awesome. And then I just finally love this perspective of hire innovative people, give them some space, and let them do what they do.
Well, I think that's what he's about. I mean, you look at his career path, he's been doing all sorts of things. Like, he just has a wealth of knowledge. It was a lot of fun.
Yeah.
Hey, so let's shift gears here. So, cracks in the pavement. You have anything for the show?
Yeah, you know, I was reading Cities Today, and they had an interesting article, because it just seems to be top of mind in everything we talk about cybersecurity in smart cities. Is the article's title is "More U.S. Cities Invest in Cyber Insurance, but Costs Are Rising." And so it talks about this survey that, you know, 59% of local government technology leaders say their cybersecurity budget has increased this year, but 58% still say it's not enough to support security initiatives and cloud initiatives. And so I think it's just an interesting article around all of these trade-offs that, you know, you think as a citizen, hey, just go out there and protect it, build it, protect
exactly.
it. But as a city manager, CIO, CISO,
No one wants to get that call that some third party has their key systems locked down and off, and they're the only ones that know how to turn it on, and they need to pay some X amount of cryptocurrency before they get it turned on. No, seriously, like, in my new gig at K-12 for the Arizona Department of Education, there have been some prominent school districts that have had it happen. There's been some prominent cities that have had it happen. And, you know, one of the things we're thinking about is how do we pool scale to get cyber insurance at the right cost that actually they can afford it, so it's not an either or, it's a no-brainer. And that's maybe something that we could look at possibly through the Connective. Who knows? Maybe an opportunity of someone listening that has an amazing program, and maybe we can get more to do it at scale somehow. Same for K-12. Like, these are things that they need to protect themselves, but maybe they don't even have a CISO that's thinking about it. Maybe. Yeah.
Totally. That's what they say. They say, I mean, I can't tell who they surveyed, but they said only 55% said their organizations now have a CISO. I mean, 55%. And some of them said they have a dual role, but right. 50, that's, you know, 45% out there don't have a CISO who's thinking about security. And it's just, I mean, again, it's, you know, they don't have a limited budget, you know, and
you don't have it until you need it. And when you need it, it's
too late.
It's not a laughing matter. I'm serious. Like, it keeps me up at night, Department of Education, that I'm going to get, you know, something like that. You know, we've got decent program. We have a dual ops leader with CISO, and we're putting together some programs of some improvement areas, just because I've been doing some security related work at Honeywell and ASU. But yeah, it's one of the things when people ask me what keeps me up at night.
And I mean, just because, you know, of who we just had on with the police, it reminds me of all the conversations back when I used to work for a city, right? And you're asking electeds to invest in this kind of infrastructure in cybersecurity or CISO, but the community wants more police officers. And so it's always a battle to try to prioritize budget, because it's, you know, the typical thing is, oh, if I just pay for more police, citizens are going to be happy, I'm going to get reelected.
Yeah, exactly.
But now it's these kinds of things that are creeping up too. So it's just an interesting challenge for local governments.
Cool. Well, good find. That's a wrap. Till next time. See y'all. Take it easy.
Have a good one.
Thanks for listening to The Urban Complex, smarter cities for a stronger tomorrow. Please find us on where you listen, Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or YouTube. We do love your feedback. Let us know if you have ideas for guests or questions to air on Cracks in the Pavement via social media. The Urban Complex is found on LinkedIn, Facebook, and Twitter. Or just shoot me an email, chris@theurbancomplex.com. Till next time.